in agriculture, every field it is using, either it is medical science, biological science, remote sensing, weather forecasting, everywhere. So what is actually data? Data are the facts and figure collected, analyzed and summarized for the presentation and interpretation. Whatever the decision making we are doing, it is based on only our data. If our data is good, so if data is very long also, so by the collecting the figures, we can go for some interpretation. So normally data are two types. One is qualitative data and second is qualitative and quantitative. So qualitative data includes the labels or name to identify the attribute of each elements, like the types of televisions that the customer is liking to purchase. But qualitative data, it deals with numerical value, like the average revenue of food market or average crop production of any crop, or you can suddenly simply say that present situation, that COVID cases, now total number of cases, all that is also qualitative, quantitative. So statistics is having role, just already I mentioned that statistics is already having big role in all the aspects of the globe, all the fields, departments, so agriculture, allied sectors and other sectors also, we are using this statistics. Also, you won't believe that in agriculture and every multidisciplinary multinational companies are using the statistical tool to get the results in very less time with high precision. So there are some benefits also. So benefits we will talk later, but before the statistical, just see this point number three. This is the base of all the analysis. Without this analysis, if you either you are doing design of experiment, principal component, sampling, whatever the analysis you are doing, without this point three, we can't go further. So before the statistical handling analysis, data handling is also important, and see the variability of data. Next few slide, we will see that how these things, mean, median, mode and coefficient of variation affected our results also. And I know there are a lot of students are there in presentation, so I will request just keep concentrate on this slide, so it will very helpful. Point number four is also very important, that variability affect the results of data analysis. We will see that one data point also can change the whole scenario of the our results. So that's why we are saying that data handling and data reducing the data variability is very important. So we will see the some examples by the level of significance and Tukey's mean separation. We will see that how this data variability is important. So before we will, because we are talking about the SPSS, so in SPSS we will see some data, ratio, interval, ordinal and nominal. So this is the thing, but I want to show you in applied manner that how it actually work. First I am talking about the nominal data. If we only concentrate on here A and B, serial number and color, so we are having three colors, red, blue and green, and there are no order between these colors data. So we can't do analysis with this data point, red, blue and green, okay, and they are not ordered also. But if we ask by some people that what is your favorite color, so few people will say, five people say that five is, people so told that red is my favorite, three for blue and green for 10. So this data we can use as a nominal and we can analyze this data. So in SPSS we need to understand also that what information can go for the statistical analysis also. Then second we will go for the ordinal data. Ordinal in the sense something is data is having rank. Here is, it is example of the race winner. There are first three person are there who are the first, second and third position. So by seeing this two, by seeing this result, we can't do anything because they are ordered. And 1, 2 minus 1 and 3 minus 1, all are coming 1, means there are no difference, difference cannot be measured. But when we, so by seeing this information, this is kind, you can say ordinal. But when we are saying that first person who win the race, completed his race in 4.53, second person took few second more, 4.55, and third person took more time, 6.03. So this point data we can analyze. Our other example of the ordinal data we can take, excellent, good, satisfactory, and bad. So we are taking about rank, giving the marks 1, 2, 3, 4. So here also, you can't do any analysis, just on the basis of this number, you can observe this thing, excellent, good, satisfactory. So this is the way that this is ordered, and also there is no difference, difference cannot be measured. Third, interval scale data. Here it is example of the temperature that we are having, temperature of 30, 60 and 90. So there is no true zero, means if I say, if I am taking one more point, 0 Fahrenheit, it doesn't mean that it is lowest temperature, okay, because it can go with minus 20, minus 30. So this is the thing, that no true zero and difference can be measured, means 60 minus 30 we can go minus, so we can say that 30 degrees Celsius temperature difference is there, but we can't say like that is a ratio. If we say 30 divided 60 divided by 2, so 2 degrees Celsius, so we can't justify this thing. Then ratio scale data, there is the grade scores of the student 30, 60, 56, 70, 82 and 90. So here we can say that the student are having 90 marks. So difference we can't, we can measure. Also last student having 90 marks and lowest marks is 30. So we can say that this student are having, getting three times more marks from the this student. Also after the zero, no student can get negative marking, means zero is the lowest value. So that's why here it is written zero true value. So now I am back to coming to my PPT. So that's why here it is written about that ordinal, nominal, interval and ratio data. This all in the next session of design of experiment, you will see this all the kind of data we are seeing. This is the same information given which I explained about through examples. So what is the benefits of the data variability, reducing the data variability and high precision analysis? First point is, if we are doing the, because in MSc or PhD we are doing the short term 2 years, 3 years analysis, so accuracy is important. So if we use all the use the statistical standards, so definitely our result will more accurate. In the less trial you will get the higher accuracy and you will get the save the money. I am telling you the one example, when we are I was working in one MNC, so that time due to this high precision analysis only 1 year we saved around 8 crore rupees. Means how we saved? Because we did analysis in high precision and we checked the data quality properly. So around where we before 1 year before we did 200 trials, so that year we got profit. So 100 trial we got our completed our objectives. So what is the descriptive statistics? This is the base of all the statistics. That descriptive statistics tell about the nature, about the data. it is not tell you that higher mean is there so that it is good or bad. It is just simply describe the nature of the data. That data is, where is our data, what is our data is saying. So suppose we are talking about the dispersion. So dispersion is the measure of extent which individual item vary. Means a standard deviation provides an indication that the how far the individual responses or individual item are vary. Means standard deviation does not tell about that it is good or bad. Just it will simply say that how much the individual item is spread from the responses. And it describes the distribution in the relation of the mean. Just I am showing them applied examples. So I will want to say tell you just concentrate on this table because we will definitely share this material with you. But it is important to understand this logic. Here we are having two experiments. One is having mean is 2.70 and one is 3.20. Now if we not see this standard deviation, so if we talk about yield, so by seeing this mean, somebody say that experiment 2 is good. But experiment one, because experiment one mean is less. But if you see this standard deviation, means here individual item vary from their mean 2.15. And here individual item vary from 1.06. 1 minute. Means by seeing the only one scenario or mean or standard deviation, we can't say that this one is good. If we see the actual variability, so then we only understand why this mean is coming like that or why this variation is too much. And one more thing, now practically we will see in next 10 slides that this standard deviation result also affect our mean separation test, whatever you are saying, CD, LSD, Tookie's test. So you will see this variability affect your result also. This is second example. Here you will see again two experiments we are having. One is having a standard deviation of 1.15 and second is standard deviation is zero. Why it is zero? Because here all the data points are same, means there is no deviation from the mean. So this situation is also very you can say, because in this situation we can't take any decision. So some variability is also required to get the results. And whenever you are writing the research papers or you are doing the statistical analysis, so normally people are not getting the difference between standard error and standard deviation. The standard deviation what saying that how much the individual item vary from their mean. But here it is just simply opposite. It is the indication of the reliability of the mean. This is very good point. It is taken by some good reference book that if the standard deviation help us to understand how far a sample mean is from the true population, and then we can use standard error to understand how accurate individual sample mean from the true mean. So again we are taking the three example here. One example you can see mean is here 3.2, 4.4. So here I want to spend some time because it is very important to understand. Just see here it is same situation that all the data points are same. That's why standard error and standard deviation is coming zero. Now if you see the once you just see this data point also here two data points are there, 3, 3, 4, 4. Only two numerical data points are there, but here 3, 4, 5, 7, 8, 5. So if you see critically also, so you can see that data is having variability. And here here it is less variability. That's why here it is 0.13 and here is this variability is 0. Standard error is 0.69. Now you see where is standard error is low, standard deviation is also low. Where is standard deviation is high, so standard error is high, so standard deviation is also high. The coefficient of variation, it is coming from the deviation from the standard deviation and mean. So I will not go on through about the formulas because it all in meta reference book, but I want to show you some practical examples here, because next class you are next session you are having of design of experiments also. So just you see that we are having three experiment where we are having 13.9, 27.13 and 21.25. so here also see where is CV is high, standard error is also high in experiment 2 as compared to experiment 1 and 3. Now if we graphically see where is CV is 27.13, just see all the observation is very close, 72, 39, 84, 81, 77. But due to this one data point, our standard error and coefficient of variation has been increased. But here you can say the range of data is 45 to 63 and here is 45 to 73. So the point is, if one data point is having wrong entry or having more, you can say, outlier value, so definitely it will affect on our result. So now I am talking about the why I am choosing this specific things, because all the session you are going to attend, this specific point will help you, and it help you to understand why these basic things are required. Number of what is degree of freedom, difference between the total number of items and total number of constraints. So in other words, a number of degree of freedom generally refers to the number of independent observation in a sample minus the number of population mid parameters. So just we will see some practical thing also. Just data variability is also important. Also before any analysis, it is important either we are doing correlation, regression, that data should follow the normal distribution. So you just see this blue line is having normality curve, but up to 5-10 degree, it is little bit differ. But when we are doing with going more than 12 degree freedom, so it does the normality. How it does the normality, just you see in next slide. This is you can get this t distribution table in any book, but the point is here that 95% interval that we are normally saying that 12 degree freedom is required for the RBD, LSD and CRD. But why they are saying that 12 degree is required? The answer is, when if you see the result of 12 degree of freedom, so one you can see that 2.79, 2.16. So after the 12 degree of freedom, or if the experiment is having 12 degree of freedom, so we can get the small we can detect the small difference between the treatment also. Like one treatment is having 2.06 mean and second treatment mean is 2.02. so if we follow this small 12 degree of freedom rule, so definitely we can get some benefit about the treatment difference. This is very important section, because when we are talking about the mean separation, why we are doing? To compare that which pair of the treatments are significantly different to each other. So normally we are talking the taking in CD LSD values, but if you say present trend, that CDLSD we are not taking, and globally and internationally also. Tukey's mean suppressant method is approved, because when we are taking the CD and LSD value, so just you see what is the drawback of CD and LSD. Overall error rate. Overall error rate, control over overall error rate, no, easy to interpretation, okay. But here you see that control overall error rate means, you just see here we are having same four treatments, where you can see that F value is no significant difference between the treatment, but in LSD it is showing that significance difference, means it is misleading. But same data you analyzed and seen Tukey's mean suppression, so just see no significant difference is coming, and here you can say all the letters are same, means treatments are not having significant difference. The reason behind that, if I go here, four treatments are there, so treatment 1 to 2, 3 to 4 and 3 to control. Actually, experiment wise error rate is decreasing, but in Tukey's mean suppression, experiment wise error rate is not decreasing. When in beginning we selected 95% confidence interval, so after the experiment error rate also is remains same, means it will not increase the error rate of the study. Just see expected error rate and confidence. So here in beginning starting we selected 95 95, but after actual error rate when we concluded, so it decreased from 0.26 and 0. It remains same. So that's why this is my suggestion also, if you are doing any PG, PhD research, or you are publishing any paper, so use this Tukey's test. Do not go for this thing. It will be very helpful, and in international, it help you to easy publication also. Now, the point we started from the mean, standard deviation and standard error. So suppose this is the experiment of 12 treatment, and you just first concentrate here. I will say two things. First, you concentrate on mean 2.97 and lower value is 0.73. And standard error of all the treatments are less than 1. So you can see clearly that we are getting the, here treatments are having less numerical difference, but statistically they are having good difference to each other, AB, AC, like that. Why it happened? Because here data variability is less. And this example, whatever I am showing, we have tested around more than 500 trials. And in 500 trials, we got this point that if the standard error and standard deviation is high, so if the treatments are having having more numerical differences also, but you won't get any statistical difference. Like here treatment 12 is having 45.83 higher mean, and 10 is having less mean 32.50. So you can see that treatments are having numerical difference, 45 high and 32 is less. But if you see here a standard error, so you can see 5 4 6 7 7 6 6 5, so this difference is coming due to this standard error. And also one point is, just see here it is result a 95% confidence interval, means we are only expecting the 5% error rate, and when we are expecting 20% error rate, so result also change. But when we can go for the 80%, when we are having 3 4 5 years past experience of that data, then we know the nature of that product or seed or anything, then only we can go for 80%. But when we are going to test any new product or we are going for any country level registration, that time we should go for the 95% confidence interval. And we should not worried about this, that treatments are not having any numerical difference, because by the having, because this is raw data, so you can explain that due to this we are not getting here any new statistical difference. So statistical analysis is one point, same time defending our data is also very important. Now I will come to our main part of SPSS. So what is actually meaning of the SPSS, statistical package for the social sciences? When you are having data, using this software, so when we are using this, first I want to show you this, that we are, when we, this is SPSS data sheet. So one is data view, where row variables, column variables, we can see under the data view. And this is the method that how we can open our file. So we can, 1 minute. We can open our file first, and we have to go with the open, and then we have to go for the data where our data is saved in Excel or whatever program, but we have to select the program like a Excel, that which program we are selecting the data. And this is the type of view, that type of variable. Here we are giving the type of variable, then we are giving the numeric data, is numeric or string. String data means the data is having the characters, or you can say no numerical values, like name, or giving the some holidays name, like that it is coming. And description of the table, if somewhere it is written variable name is like X, Y, Z, so we can give label also, like age and whatever you want, age, weight, height, whatever the your variables are there, and decimal. So if you want more after decimal 2-3 points, so you can increase or decrease the this decimal point also. So actually what happened that morning also my system is class, so night or most probably within 1 or 2 days I will share the one recording also, that what is this type of variable and this type of numeric and string, so you can more easily understand this program, that how it is working. Now how it is, we can import our data. First here we can, in column also we can manually enter the data, like Excel we are working, so we can enter the data here also manually, and we can give the variable name here, and we can give the label. But suppose if we are having already any data in Excel sheet, so what we have to do, recent file, hospital stay data, and we have to, because data is our in Excel, so where we our system in data, so first we have to go into that position, and then we have to select as the type, select the files of type. If it is Excel, so we have to select Excel, and then we have to click on open. So when we are importing, now it is asking here after opening, because maybe it's possible that you are having more than one sheet where the data is having. So if you are working, want to work in sheet number one, so select sheet number one. But if you want to sheet number 2, 3, 4, so just go to this drop down and select the sheet number, and the click on the OK button. Now, data is imported from the Excel system to our SPSS program. Now we can just simply put here, save this file as SPSS data. So if we click on here, so this is the save button. So we can save this file also in our system. And already we discussed a lot about the descriptive statistics, that what it help. It help to find out the wrong entries. Wrong entries means maybe some outlier data, some of the data which is you researcher know that it is not correct, and summarization of the data before going for any depth analysis. Summary of the data is required, like minimum, maximum, or data mean, standard error, standard deviation. So how we can get that descriptive statistic from the mean, median, mode? So just go to analyze section, and analyze section you will get to frequency. Now we have selected only five variables, and just go to statistics here. And after selecting the statistics and click on the OK, we will get this table like 1, 2, that 11 and 14. There are two data, one data point which are having 11 frequencies, and two second data point is having 14. Okay, and so this way we can check the frequency of the data. So this is the also one way to check the our data quality. We can prepare the histogram and box plot also, that how it looks like. So we can do that time series and simple summary statistics, design of experiment, and you are having lot of sessions, like next session is on design of experiment, and we can do principal component analysis, we can do artificial neural networking also, ERIMA, GERCH, ERCH. This all the time series analysis we can do. Also we can do the survival and reliability analysis also. Trend analysis we can do. Trend analysis in the sense when we are checking that data is having linearity or data is having exponential smoothing. So this is all the things we can do. So definitely in a, because my system is suddenly crashed in morning, so I will try to recover and send you that all the how we can do these things, like in recording that how we can do this descriptive statistics, how we can run the prepare the scatter chart or box plot, because rest of the advanced things you will get in the next session. This is the some options are coming: file, edit, view, data, transform, analyze, graph, utility, add-on, window, and help. One thing I forget to tell you, suppose it is output of our data, so simply we can copy paste this data into our Word file or Excel file. Just simply we have to click on right click, and we have to paste in our required Word or Excel file. Okay, and same way we can copy paste into figure also. And if we want to save all this file in a one file, all the results in a one file, so simply we have to go for the save as, where it will give the option to save as in a Word file. So where we can get this all the results in a tabular and graphical form. This is the some menu bars which I already mentioned here, that menu bar we are having file, edit, view. In view also I think one toolbar is there which is showing the progress of our analysis. If it is in somewhere we are in a, our program is not working, so that is stuck also. Also SPSS is very user friendly, you can say, just like I told. Here you can see these are our inbuilt program, like descriptive statistics, you can get the mean, median, mode, CV, and all the things. compare mean you or general linear model, here you will see that how we can analyze the CRD, RBD, LSD, then we can calculate the correlation regression. Here we have to not do any kind of coding, just simply we have to import our data and we have to just use this inbuilt option in SPSS, and this neural network we also can do, and non-parametrics also it is possible to do. Forecasting already I mentioned, and data reduction method like principal component factor analysis method is also possible. I think thank you very much, and it would be just give me 1 or 2 days, so I will try to share the all the information that how we can import export the data about my 15 minutes slides, 15 or 20 minutes recording. So definitely I will share with the organizing team in tonight or within 1 or 2 days. Thank you so much. Seema ma'am.
Hello? Yes sir. Yes sir. Yes sir. Thank you so much sir for your very much useful presentation. Sir, we have a query actually. Just wait, wait. Sir, we have queries from Girish Prabhu. He is asking, is SPSS software is open source?
Yeah, one second ma'am, 1 minute. Yes ma'am.
Girish Prabhu sir is asking, is SPSS software is open source?
We can get free trials, but if anyone is want to this software, so definitely I will tell that connect me, so in my email ID, and they are having my mobile number also, so I will try to provide.
Okay sir. Two questions are same.
Anyone is required SPSS, so just they can, if they are from their respective university, so they can get, or if they want, so they can connect to me also. I will help you.
Okay sir, one more question is here. Dr. Ganesh Rede is asking, is it possible to do data envelopment analysis in SPSS?
Can we unmute this person? Dr. Ganesh, just please tell me.
Yes sir, can we do the data envelopment analysis in the SPSS software? For efficiency analysis sir.
Efficiency analysis, I think
for PRS and VRS.
For that you have to a little bit do the syntax working or coding work. Okay, directly in built option it is not possible. Somebody is asking that factorial design possible in SPSS or not, so it is possible. Okay,
thank you sir.
Any more question ma'am?
One question is from Ramesh Bhutta sir. When to use SD and SE in analysis?
We need, before going for any advanced analysis, we need to do this standard error and standard deviation, because without checking the data variability, if we are doing the analysis, so after few times we will mislead our result also. So in beginning, if we check the data quality and run the descriptive statistics, so it will help you.
Okay, thank you so much sir. Pradeep sir.
Yes ma'am.
Next session is from Dr. Manoj Kanti Devnath. Is he joined or not?
He can join, but he is joining I think. So I am leaving the meeting, ma'am, so he can join. Okay. And can you share the my email ID and password to them, or I should what I will do?
Put your email ID in chat box.
Okay. Manoj sir is already joined. Yeah. Okay, ma'am. Thank you. I think we can start next session.
Okay.
So can I explain little bit and give the information about that Dr. Manoj Kanti? Hello, Seema ma'am.
Yes, sir.
Yeah. So all participants, so our next speaker is Dr. Manoj Kanti Devanath, who is assistant professor in statistics in Department of Statistics in UBKV, Uttar Bangla Krishi Vishwavidyalaya, and he has completed his MSc from the JNKVV, and he is the gold medalist during his MSc, and also he has done his PhD from the BCKV West Bengal. He has published several good articles in international and national reputed journals, and he is having more good number of citations also. So I will request to Dr. Manoj Kanti sir to join the give the details of next session.
Hello.
Yeah, sir. We can hear you, sir.
Okay. The screen is visible?
Yes, sir. It is visible.
Yes, sir.
Yeah. This PPT is also visible, I think.
Yeah, sir.
Okay. So, first of all, good afternoon to everyone. And here I want to thanks to the organizer for giving me the opportunity to deliver a lecture in this scientific gathering. So, here today my topic is design of experiment. So this is very important topic. So basically there will be two parts in my lecture. First, I'll give the brief idea about the different types of design and what is the this design of experiment, and when we use which type of design, all those things, brief idea. And then after that, I'll go for hands-on training. Okay. So first of all, means if we talk about design of experiment, actually design of experiment can broadly classified into three categories. First, we have to plan the experiment. Secondly, we have to obtain the relevant information. And thirdly, we have to do the statistical analysis of that information and drawing the inference. So here, if you experiment is not well designed, so in that case, what will happen? So in that case, the validity of your statistical inference may be questionable, and sometimes it may be invalid. So there are some basic principles. I think all of you knows the replication, randomization, and local control. So here, replication means it is just a repetition of a treatment. Okay. So the replication is a repeated application of the treatment among the experimental unit. So now here I think most of us sometimes we used to confuse how many replication we should keep. So for this we have to examine this graph. Okay, so this plot, in this plot the one side there is a degrees of freedom, and other side there is a F values. So if you observe it, See, after 12 degrees of freedom, the F value becomes stabilized. Okay, F value becomes stabilized. So now, from this, if you conclude, we need that mass of replication, which will give you the at least 12 degrees of freedom for error. So that's why we always try to keep 12 degrees of freedom for error. Okay. So next is randomization. So randomization means it is nothing, it is just a random allocation of a treatment to the various experimental unit. Okay. So if you don't do the randomization, so what will happen? So there will be a chance of arising the biasness. So that's why randomization is essential. So there is a different method are there for randomization. You can use random number table. There is some other method also is there. And thirdly, third principle is local control. So what is local control? So actually, by using this local control, we are reducing the experimental error. Okay. So so how we are reducing the experimental error? So here, we have the idea of uniformity trial. Okay, what is uniformity trial? So to understand this, you have to know the uniformity trial. So in uniformity trial, what we used to do? We used to grow a short duration crop. Then we used to collect the data from the field. Then on the basis of this yield data, we draw a fertility contour map. Okay, though the fertility gradient of the field are very erratic in shape. Okay. Means it is very zigzag way. Though we will get at least a general idea about the fertility status of the field. So based on this fertility status, we draw the fertility contour map. So on the basis of this fertility contour map, we used to prepare the block. So if your the block you should prepare the block in such a way that it should be perpendicular to the fertility gradient. Okay. So there is a principle of blocking, means if you here you have to prepare the block in such a way that block should be as homogeneous as possible, and there should be a heterogeneity between the block. Okay, so by dividing the heterogeneous experimental material into homogeneous blocks, we are reducing the experimental error. So this is the here this way this local control helps in reducing the experimental error. So there is some list of design which I will try to cover in this lecture. CRD, RBD, LSD, then factorial experiment, split plot design, strip plot design, and combined experiment or groups of experiment. Okay, so I'll give a brief idea about all these design, means when we'll use this design and how many factor we need, all those things. The first is CRD. CRD, we all know it is the simplest of all the design. Okay, yeah, we'll use this CRD when our experimental material is homogeneous. That is, where our experimental material will be homogeneous, when you conduct the experiment in the lab condition or in greenhouse condition. Okay. So here the randomization process, it is very simple. First, you have to determine the total number of experimental unit, then assign a plot number to the each of the experimental unit, then assign this treatment to this experimental unit by using random number table. I think all of you know how to see the random number table. Statistical model. Actually, the statistical model you should know for all the design, statistical model you should know, because from this model only, means you will get the different source of variation. Once you know the source of variation, you can easily write the model. Okay. So see, in case of CRD, source of variation, there's a treatment. So degrees of freedom, we all know what is degrees of freedom. So if there is a K number of treatment, then degrees of freedom will be K minus one. It is just an independent observation, we can say. So in design of experiment, actually our main task is to calculate the different sum of square. Okay, different sum of square is the main task to calculate. So once you calculate the different sum of square, you can easily calculate the mean sum of square. Okay, by dividing the this sum of square by their corresponding degrees of freedom. So after calculating the mean sum of square, you have to calculate the F ratio. Okay, this is we can call it F calculated value also. So here, see here, F1 is equal to ST square by S square. That means mean sum of square due to treatment divided by mean sum of square due to error. Okay, so this is our calculated F value. So now our next task is to compare this calculated F value with the tabulated F value. We have to compare this F value with the tabulated F value at which degrees of freedom? At k minus 1 and n minus k degrees of freedom. So now, if your calculated F value, that means F1, is greater than the your F tabulated value. Okay. So in that case, what will happen? So see here, I think you have already know this null hypothesis and alternative hypothesis. For any experiment, first you have to set your null hypothesis and your alternative hypothesis. So in this case, say what will be your null hypothesis? See, so here what you are doing, you are testing the different means. Okay, more than two mean. See, when you are testing for two mean or difference of two mean, in that case we can easily use the t-test. But if you want to test the more than two mean, so in that case you cannot use the t-test. For this you have to go for ANOVA. So here, when you have a more than two mean, so in that case your null hypothesis will be, what will be your null hypothesis? Null hypothesis will be all treatment means are equal. Okay, and alternative hypothesis is it will be alternative to the your null hypothesis. So now, if your calculated F value, that is F1, is greater than your tabulated value, in that case what will be our conclusion? In that case we will reject the null hypothesis and we'll accept the alternative hypothesis. Okay, so if you reject the null hypothesis, that means we are accepting the alternative hypothesis. What is our alternative hypothesis? All treatment means are not equal. That means there is a difference among the treatment means. So in that case, we will calculate the standard error of difference of mean, SED, that is root over 2 S square by R. SE means mean sum of square due to error divided by number of repetition, that is R. And then we will calculate the critical difference value. That is also called the least significant difference value. Okay. So formula is SED into T tabulated value at alpha level of significance and N minus K degrees of freedom. That means error degrees of freedom. Okay. So again, if F1, that is F calculated value, is less than the your F tabulated value. Okay. If it is less, then in that case, we will accept the null hypothesis. That means all treatment are equal. So in that case, no need to go for further calculation. That means for you, no need to calculate those SED and CD, because in that case, there is no significant difference. No need to check it. Okay. So then after calculating the CD value, if F1 is greater than your F tabulated value, in that case, what you will check? You have to check the difference of mean. Okay, mean difference. If any two treatment mean difference is greater than the your CD value. Okay, if any two treatment mean difference, okay, is greater than the your CD value, that means in that case we will say that two treatment are differ significantly. Okay, if the difference of two mean is less than your this CD value, in that case we'll say that these two treatment are not differ significantly with each other, they are at par. Okay, so So next here we have to calculate the CV value. Okay. CV. So what is CV here? CV actually express the experimental error as a percentage of mean. So actually CV indicate the degree of precision with which the treatment are compared, and it is the good index of the reliability of your experiment. That means if your if your CV is high, that means we can say that your experiment is less reliable. If your CV is less, then we can say your experiment is more reliable. Okay, actually CV generally varies. If we say for suppose yield data or some if you do any varietal trial, in that case CV generally varies 6 to 8%. Okay, so this is my experience. I am telling, and some insecticide trial or pesticide trial, in that case it generally varies from 10 to 15%. It is acceptable. Okay, more than this there will be some we can say the reliability will be questionable of your experiment. Okay, next is your RBD, randomized block design. So this is the most widely widely used design in agriculture research. I think most of people are using RBD only. So when we use it, when our experimental material are heterogeneous, so when we go to field condition, so there you will not get the homogeneous condition. So in that case your experimental material are heterogeneous. Okay, so if it is heterogeneous, then you have to make the blocking and all. You have to make it will make the homogeneous blocks to reduce the local control. See, among the three principle of experimental design, so RBD use all the principle, but CRD we no need to use the local control because our experimental material is already homogeneous. And here one more thing is there, when fertility gradient are in one direction. Okay, in field, if the fertility gradient is in one direction, then we'll go for RBD. Sometimes it may happen that your fertility gradient is in two direction, then in that case we'll go to LSD design. So in RBD, see, this is your total field, and after uniformity trial you have seen that your fertility gradient is in this direction, then you have to prepare the block perpendicular to the fertility gradient. So we have prepared the block like this. This is block 1, block 2, block 3, block 4. Okay, so within the block, yeah, if you have a 5 treatment, you have to do the randomization like this separately for each block. Okay, so statistical model. So here you see y is equal to mu plus Ti plus Rj and epsilon ij. Here you see two more treatment plus this replication or block, we can say both are equal here. So here one more component is added. Okay, in source of variation, if you see in the ANOVA, treatment and replication, this one we can say block also, replication or block. Okay, replication or block. So in CRD there was only treatment, there was no block. In RBD there is treatment as well as block is there. Okay, so if you make more partition, okay, your error will be automatically reduced, and the experimental precision will be increased. So that's why RBD is more efficient than CRD, and LSD will be more efficient than RBD. Okay, so here also similar thing. If you have a T number of treatment, degrees of freedom T minus 1, R number of if there is a R number of replication, then their degrees of freedom will be R minus 1. Similarly here also we have to calculate the different sum of square, TRSS, this replication SS or block SS. So ultimately we have to calculate the F ratio. Okay, so here our major concern is treatment. So this is your calculated F value. So here also same thing like CRD, we have to check this, we have to compare this calculated F value with the tabulated F value. So if your calculated F value is greater than the your tabulated F value, then we'll reject the null hypothesis, we'll accept the alternative hypothesis, then we go for calculation of SCT and CT value. Okay, so that part will be always same for all the design. Okay, after calculation of F ratio, so you have to compare it, then if it is significant, then you go for calculation of SCM-CT or SCD or CT. Then Latin square design. Actually, this Latin square design is a two-directional blocking, we can say it. One is row blocking and one is column blocking. Actually, when fertility gradient is two direction, I already told, when fertility gradient is two direction, we used to go for Latin square design. And it is we can use it in a field trial, some insecticide trial also, greenhouse trial also, and some this lab condition with a replication over time, we can use it. But when the number of treatment is large, the design become impractical. Okay, the Latin square, there is a great one disadvantage is there. See, if there is a five treatment, you have to there will be a repetition of five times, means there will be five row and five column. That means if your number of treatment is increased, your number of repetition of a treatment also increase. Okay, if your treatment is 10, that means you have to repeat each treatment 10 times. So there is a unnecessary increase of number of replication, we can say number of repetition. Okay, so here in practice, generally when there is a number of treatment is more than 4 and less than 8, in that case we can use the Latin square. Okay, so yeah, if it is more than 8, then in that case it become very cumbersome. Okay, so though it has a great potential, okay, LHD design is more efficient than previously explained to design like CRD and RBD, but due to this disadvantage, it is not mostly used in agricultural experiment. So here there is a we are calculating effect due to row, due to column. One is for row blocking, one is column blocking, and one is for treatment. So there will be three component in source of variation. One is treatment, one is row, and one is column. So number of partition is more than RBD and CRD. So precision will be automatically increased, and because the error will be reduced. So here also you have to compare the same thing like previously I explained. Okay, you have to calculate SCD, CD if it is significant. So next, come to factorial experiment. So suppose till now I have explained only single factor. If there is a single factor, then we can use CRD, RBD, LHD. Suppose if there is a two factor simultaneously, okay. If two factor means in an experiment, you have to include the two factors simultaneously, then in that case, you cannot use those design, but you have to go for factorial experiment. Actually, factorial, it is not a design, it is a experiment. Okay, we cannot say it a factorial design, it is a factorial experiment. See here, an experiment in which the treatment consists of all possible combination of a selected level of two or more factors. It is called factorial experiment. Suppose your yield from different plots in agriculture experiment is depends on the spacing of a crop and types of fertilizer is used. Suppose if you want to see the effect of spacing and types of fertilizer, if you use the simple RBD, you have to conduct the two separate experiments. Okay, but if you do, if you adopt the factorial experiment, in that case, you can accommodate both the factor in one experiment. Okay, so if you conduct two or more factor in an experiment, and in a field condition, then we can use the factorial RBD. If you conduct the experiment in a lab, we can use factorial CFD. Okay, that means there will be a combination of all possible combination of different levels. Okay, it will be increased just. Suppose, see here, there are generally two types of factorial exponent. One is symmetrical and one is asymmetrical. In symmetrical, all the levels of each factor will be the same. Okay, see here, 2 to the power 2 means 2 factor is there. The top one is factor and this one will be level. 2 factor, 2 level. Here, it has a 3 factor, 2 level. Like this, and this 3 square means it has a 2 factor each at 3 levels. Okay, suppose 2 factor F1 and F2 each at 3 level, L1 to L3, L1 to L3. That means both the factors have a same level, same number of level, 3 level. So that's why it is symmetrical. Suppose factor 1 has a 3 level and factor 2 has a 2 level only, L1 and L2. So this is asymmetrical. Okay. So this one will write it 3 into 2 factorial. Okay, that means first factor has a 3 level, second factor has a 2 level. So this is some basics. So statistical model, this is rho is a effect due to ith block. This is factor A, factor B, and this is their interaction. Okay. So in factorial, we used to get the interaction effect, main effect as well as interaction effect also. Okay. So if you see the ANOVA, there is a block, is the block or replication, then one will get the effect due to main effect at of factor A. This is for factor B. This is their interaction effect. Okay. So extra will get the interaction effect in factorial. So here also, same thing here also, you have to compare this F ratio with the tabulated F, F value. If it is significant, then we'll go for calculation of a CD value. So here, how to calculate the CD value? See, here you have to calculate the 3 CD value. One is for factor A, one is for factor B, and one is for interaction. So here you have a 3. See, when you calculate for factor A, then you have to divide it by replication into level of factor B. Okay. When you will calculate the CD for factor B, then you have to divide it by replication into level of factor A. And when you calculate for interaction, and just divide it by only replication, and you have to multiply it by t at alpha level of significance. Now alpha, you can use 1% or 5%. It is up to you. And error degrees of freedom. This is the tabulated value. You can easily get it from the t table. Okay. So here, I think now you can easily calculate this CD value by using this formula. So next is our split plot design. So this also one of the most important design. So split plot design means when we use it. Suppose we have a 2 factor. Okay. So among these, one factor require a larger area and other factor require a smaller area. So in that case, what we used to do, the factor which is require the larger area, we used to put it in a main plot, and the factor require a smaller area, we'll put it in a subplot. We call it subplot. Okay. I have given one example. The factor require the larger area. What are the factor like irrigation or tillage practice? Okay. Or you can say such type of factor we require the larger area. So it you cannot easily accommodate in a small area this type of factor. So in other case, you see the factor requires the smaller area, like fertilizer, the application of different types of fertilizer or different dose of fertilizer, woodicide, insecticide, all those things we can easily accommodate in a small plot. So there is a two types of factor. One factor require a larger area, other factor require a small area. So now the factor require a larger area will assign it as a main plot, and the factor require a smaller area will assign it as a subplot. Okay, now here the precision will be more for subplot. Okay, see here some small layout I have prepared it. Suppose you have a two main plot. Okay, main plot M1 and M2, two main plot and five subplot. So how will arrange it? So your first task is to divide your total experimental area into number of blocks. Okay, suppose here I divided into three blocks. Okay, after dividing the blocks from in each block, then you have to divide each block into the number of main plot you have. Suppose if you have main plot, two main plot, you divide the your each block into two main plot. Okay, so here I divide into two main plot. So after dividing the into two main plot, now in each main plot you have to randomize your subplot treatment. Okay, one by one you have to assign it. Okay, so this is the layout procedure for split plot design. So in split plot, see here in model, this is the effect due to ith replication, this is effect due to jth main plot, and this is the error. Okay, this is the, we can say, error one, and this is effect due to subplot treatment, this is interaction between main plot and subplot, and this is our error two. So till now we have seen only one error. Okay, so in split plot there is a two error. Okay, if you see the source of variation, first you see the replication, main plot, this is this error one, then there is a subplot, then main plot into subplot, then error two. Okay, so once you know the source of variation, you can easily write the model in SPSS. Okay, so so you should remember all the source of variation. What are the source of variation in each of the design? So calculation of a different critical difference. Okay, there is some formula is there, you can use it. So next, come to strip plot design. So when we will use this strip plot design? So previously I told, when we have a two factor, one factor requires the larger area and other factor requires a smaller area, in that case we will go for split plot design. Suppose when our both the factor are require larger area, okay, then in that case we cannot use the split plot. In that case we have to go for strip plot. Okay, so here see, different method of irrigation, different method of plowing, etc., require the larger plot. So when both the factor are both the factor require larger area, then we cannot use the split plot design. Okay, so here also see, first you divide into two blocks. So within block you have to divide the both side strip, one is see vertical strip and horizontal strip. You have to so you have to randomize it like this. You have to make a two strip, one is horizontal and one is vertical strip. Okay, so here you will get the more precision in case of interaction, not in subplot. Okay, so here see the model, row I, it is the block effect. First one is alpha j. Alpha j is the effect due to jth level of factor A, and this is your error one. Okay, and this is beta k is the effect of a kth level of factor B, and this is rho beta ik is the error two, and alpha beta jk means this is the interaction between factor A and factor B. And thirdly, this is your error 3. So here we are getting the 3 error. Okay. In split plot, there is only 2 error. But in case of three plot, there is 3 error. If you see the ANOVA source of variation, first in source of variation, there is a replication, then factor A, then error. Again, factor B, then there is a error 2. Again, in the factor A into factor B, then there is a third error. Okay. So this is the procedure for calculation of critical difference. As I wrote the formula here. So next you come to combined experiment or pool experiment. See, sometimes what will happen, we used to conduct same experiment in different places, okay, or different location. And you can continue your experiment throughout the 3-4 season or 3-4 year. So in that case, we have to go for combined experiment or pool experiment, okay. So for conducting the pool experiment or analysis pool experiment, first you have to test the homogeneity of the variance. Okay, so you can use the Bartlett cascade test, or there is one more test is very easy, is a Hartley test. Okay, suppose if you have a 3-4 location, okay, if you use RBD experiment in 4 location, so you have to first do the individual analysis, individual RB for all the analysis, all the location. Then you have to check the maximum error MS and minimum error means where. So if you divide it, then the result is, if it is less than 3, we can say that all the location are homogeneous. You can carry out the this combined analysis. If it is more than 3, then we cannot go for combined analysis or pool analysis. In that case, we have to go for weighted analysis. Okay. So see, the source of variation in simple RBD. I already told there is a replication, treatment, and error will come. But in case of pooled RBD, so what will be the different source of variation? There will be year, then replication within year, then treatment into year, then error. Okay. So you should know the source of variation. Then you can easily write the model in SPSS. Or you can easily carry out the any type of analysis. So source of variation for factorial RBD. Factorial RBD, this one I already told, replication, first factor, factor 1, factor 2, and their interaction. Okay. See, same thing if you conduct, if you use the pooled analysis, then what will be the source of variation? First, you have to see the year, then replication within year, then factor 1, then you have to see the factor 1 into year interaction. Next is factor 2, effect due to factor 2, and then factor 2 into year interaction. And factor 1 into factor 2 interaction, and lastly factor 1 into factor 2 into year interaction. So these are the source of variation for pool factorial RBD. And next is your pool split plot design. Similarly, see, first there will be a year will come, then the replication within year, these two components will always come in pool experiment. Then you come to main plot, then year into main plot, then there will be an error. In split plot, I already told there will be two error. One is error 1 and one is error 2. And this error 1, if you want to write in SPSS, you have to write it like this. Okay, year into replication into main plot, because you cannot write in the model like error 1. Okay, so software will not understand. So in that case, you have to write year into replication into main plot like this. So remaining thing as it is, you can write. So so one more important thing is there, data transformation. So this also very important. So we generally used to confuse which type of transformation we should use. So actually data transformation is why it is essential, because generally field experiment, in field experiment data generally does not follow the normal distribution, and sometimes data may have a very high CV value. So in that case we should go for data transformation to stabilize this variance. It is also called variance stabilizing transformation. So generally we use three types of transformation: square root transformation, logarithmic transformation, and angular or arc sine transformation. So square root transformation, when we use, actually when variance is proportional to mean, means variance and mean are equal. And if I tell small whole number, that is, we should see the count data first. Count data, like number of infested plant in a pot, or number of insect caught in a trap, or number of wheat per plot. So such type of data, count data, and which will be small data. Okay, so this type of data we should go for square root transformation. And sometimes, and so we should go for square root transformation and for the percentage data. Like when your percentage data range either from 0 to 30% or between 70 to 100%, not the both. Okay, so in that case also we can use the square root transformation. Next is your logarithmic transformation. Here the variance is proportional to the square of the mean. So generally we should use it for the different growth measurement. Okay, when your data related to the different growth measurement, like length or weight of a tree or plant, number of plant insect, or number of egg mass per unit area. So like this type of data we should go for logarithmic transformation. And generally we use log of x plus 1 or log of 2x plus 1, you can use it. And thirdly, angular transformation or arc sine transformation. Actually this angular or arc sine transformation we use for percentage data. So now here actually we have to transform the those percentage data who have derived down. Okay, 40%. Okay, so we should not transform such type of data. Suppose if I say percent infestation or infestation or something like this. You see the three conditions. For a percentage data ranging either between 0 to 30% or 70 to 100%, but not the both, the square root transformation should be used. Okay, this one I already told. For percentage data ranging between 30 to 70%, no transformation is required. Okay, the percentage data which is ranging between 30 to 70%, no transformation is required, because such type of data is assumed that they follow the normal distribution. Hardly left about this two situations.
Sir, your sound is breaking.
Yes, sir.
Sir, your sound is breaking.
Hello. Hello. Hello, sir. Hello.
Sir, it's audible, but the sound is breaking, sir. It's breaking.
Oh. Sir, 1 minute, sir. Hello, sir. Is it okay now?
Sir, now it's audible, sir. You continue, sir. Thank you.
So, the situation, we should go for arcs and transformation. That means the minimum value may be 20% or maximum value may be 60%, 70%. That means it will overlap the 100% or 70%. It will overlap all the condition. Then in that case we should go for arcs and transformation. Okay. So generally you sine inverse root over p. P is the your percentage data. So now I'll go to your hands-on training. So I should more focus on this. So sir, is it visible SPSS? Hello.
Yes, sir.
Now it is okay.
Visible. So first you should how to arrange the data. Keep the data like to R3 like this, okay, side by side. So for analysis, you should arrange the data. First, you should keep the R1. Then after R1, you put R2 data, that means second replicated data, replication, fourth replication. So one up, okay. And accordingly, you have to write this side, okay. So here, how many treatment are there? There is a five treatment and each are repeated how many times? Five times. Okay. So I'll just copy it. Control C. Okay, I just copy it and you directly paste it here. Paste. Okay. So now you change the variable name. Okay. So here it came variable 1, variable 2. Okay. So you should rename it. So how will you rename it? See here, first one is your data view. There is two view. One is data view. So if you want to change the name of the variable, you should go to variable. Okay. In variable view, see, if you click here, so it is highlighted. So now you can directly write here, type here. First one is treatment. Okay. So now you come to again data view. So you can note. So yeah, so you need means if you think that you can take one pen and paper step. So first, I'll go to analyze, then go to general linear model, then I'll go to univariate. Okay, univariate. Now we'll got a new windows. So in this, see, our yield will be dependent variable. So click on this yield and click on this arrow. It will go to in dependent variable. Next, you click on this treatment and click this in this arrow. So it will go to fixed factor. Okay. I think you got my point. So next is, you have to write the model. Click on the model. Okay, so CRD is the simplest design. Okay, so here only treatment is there. So see, there is a two options. One is full factorial, one is custom. So you always you will go to custom. Click on the custom. Okay. After clicking on custom, you click on this treatment and click on this arrow. So treatment is included in the model now. Okay. So if you see the slide, there is in CRD there is treatment, only treatment is there. So that's why in model there will be a treatment, only treatment will be there. So I'll go to continue. Okay, so next we'll go to option. Okay, first means I have specified the model. Next I'll go to option. Okay, so here you will get the different mean, estimated marginal mean. So you can get the overall mean and different treatment means. Okay, then after taking it this side, display mean for overall and treatment, then click continue. Okay, so first model, then option, and thirdly we'll go to post hoc test. So test means in post hoc test, why it is essential? Actually post hoc test will do for grouping. Okay, there is a different types of post hoc test is there. LSD, Duncan test is there, Tucky is there. So actually this LSD test, when your treatment is means number of treatment is less, in that case your LSD test is suitable, because LSD is used all pair of comparison. But when the number of treatment is large, that time this LSD test is become very cumbersome. Okay, so in that case it is better to use the Duncan test. Okay, and Tucky test we generally use in the experiment where we require very high precision. So in that case we use the Tucky test. So here the Duncan test and LSD test also show you. See, you will do the post hoc comparison for treatment. So click on this treatment and take it this side. Okay, post hoc test for treatment. So now you see the LSD is there and Duncan. So I'll see that this both. Okay, then continue. So here I have done only three option. One is model, then option, and post hoc test. The three is enough. Then I click OK. So now you see the ANOVA here. This is the ANOVA treatment. You forget about these two previous two. Okay, intercept and corrected one model. This is different thing. But you have to see the treatment, error, and total. See the treatment. Means we are having five treatment, then degrees will be four, then the mean sum of square is there, F value and significant. So now here your calculated F value is 201.1. okay, so significance value means this is a probability value. Okay, if this value is less than 0.05, so we can say that treatment are significant at 5% level. Yeah, if it is less than 0.01, so here we can say that treatment are significant at 1% level of significance. So here value is 0.00, that means it is less than 5% or 1%, that means it is significant at both the level. So now if it is significance, then see here we'll go to multiple comparison. Okay, post hoc test. See the post hoc test. First one is multiple comparison. This is the LSD test, and this is your Duncan test. Okay. See, first I will tell about the Duncan one. So how you will read it? That means here you see the treatment number 5, 4, 2, 1, 3. This is the treatment number, treatment 5, treatment 4, treatment 2, treatment 1, and treatment 3. And you see this subset, there is a 4 subset. Okay, there is a 4 subset. So here you see in subset number 4, there is only one treatment 3. Okay, in subset 3, there is a 2 treatment, treatment 1 and 2. Okay, that means treatment 1, treatment 1 and treatment 2 does not differ significantly with each other. They are at par. But treatment 3 is differ significantly with all the treatment, because it is there is no other other treatment in this subset. Similarly, this is the 74.36. It is the treatment number 4, and this is your treatment number 5. Okay. So here, your treatment number 4 and treatment number 5 also differ significantly with each other, and it also differs significantly with 2, 1, and 3. So now it is now. Depends on your character, which character you are studying here. So since treatment number 3 gives the highest yield in terms of yield, if you see it, treatment number 3 is giving the highest yield, and it is significantly differ with all others. That means we can say that treatment number 3 is the best as compared to all other treatment. Okay. So here, see here, treatment, the pair treatment 1 and 2, there is no significant difference. If you see in LSD also, treatment 1 and treatment 2, see, there is this is not significant, treatment 1 and treatment 2 combination. Even similarly, treatment 2 and 1 also, it will not be significant. But remaining, you see, all are 0.0000, okay, all are significant, okay, same result you are getting in Duncan and LSD. Okay, see, so here we have only 5 treatment. See, table become very big. If you have a 10 treatment, there will be a huge treatment combination, huge pairwise treatment combination. That's why for large number of treatment, we should not go for this LSD test. In that case, it is better to use the Duncan test. So now next I'll go to RBD. In RBD, see, we have here in this example, we have a 12 treatment, and each treatment, there is a how many replication? There is a 3 replication. See, I told, first see the arrangement. All 12 treatment, for all 12 treatment, the first replication data I keep. For all 12 treatment, second replication data is here, and third replication data is here. That means you should arrange the data first. You should keep the first replication data, then second replication data, and then third replication data, one after one, not side by side. Okay. So now, similarly, means I just copy and this copying the data. Control C. Copy. I'll use the new data sheet. So how will get the new data sheet? Go to file, new data. Okay, new blank data sheet. Data. Okay. So now, right click and paste. So this is our data view, and similarly go to variable view, and here, first one is our treatment, second is application, and third is FW threshold. Okay, so now the variable name has been changed. So here same procedure, first you have to go to analyze, then go to general linear model, then univariate. Okay, analyze, general linear model, univariate. So same window came. So here what will be our dependent variable? Fresh weight will be our dependent variable. Then these two, treatment and replication, will be your fixed factor. Then select these two, both treatment and replication. Then click on this arrow. It will go to your fixed factor. So now you have to write the model. So specify the model, full factorial and custom. So you should always remember that you should go to custom. Click on the custom. So now you see the ANOVA source of variation for RBD. I already told. What were the source of variation? Treatment and replication. See here, treatment and replication. Take these both, include these two in the model. See, I'll take, click on the replication and click on this arrow. So it had included, the replication has included in the model. Next, click on the treatment and click on this arrow. Then it also included in the model. So only these two is there in the model. Then you go to continue. Okay, continue. Next, I'll go to option. In option, for what purpose I'll go to option? For getting the means. Okay, different means. So here I'll go to the overall mean and treatment means. Replication means we don't need the replication mean. We need only treatment means and overall means. So overall means, why we need? We can calculate the CV value by using the overall mean or grand mean. And now, after taking these two, this side, click on the continue. Continue. Next, post-hoc test. See, here we are having 12 number of treatment. Okay, if you do the LSD test, see here what will be the size of the table. Okay, I'll show you here. Treatment, so post-hoc test will do for treatment, no need for replication. See, LSD and Duncan, both I click here, continue. So it is, so now it is completed. Model, I have specified, then in option, I have specified the means for which factor we need the means. Then post hoc, which type of test we'll use here. So now click on the OK. Okay. So I got the output here. Treatment, see that there is a 12 treatment and there is a 3 replication. Okay. And see the your treatment is significant. Okay, probability is 0.000. That means it is significant at both the level. So if it is significant, now you see the LSD test and here. So now you see the treatment number is 12. So now how many combinations are there? See, the table become very big. So that's why for large number of treatment, you should not use the LSD. So in that case, you should go for Duncan test. So this is the Duncan table. Okay. So similarly, you can interpret it. So this is the treatment number. Okay. T1, T5, T6, T4. T2, T3, like this, last one is T9. Okay, so there is a 8 subset. There is a 8 subset. So in some of the research paper you have seen, they used to write ABC like this. So here also you can write easily ABC. You can start from any side. A, B, C, D, E, F, G, H. Or you can cite from the last. A, B, C, D, okay. From any of the direction you can start. So now, if you start from the last, so 8, A, B, C, C, like this. So treatment number 9, the mean of a treatment number 9 in the table, you put A, okay. And treatment number 8, you put B. And treatment number, 6, there is a treatment number 10, you put C. And what about treatment number 12? Treatment number 12 is present in both C and D. So in treatment number 12, you should write CD. Understand? So next, for treatment number 11, you should write DE. So like this, you can write it easily. So here you see in the mean table, one more thing you should know. In the mean table, you are seeing there is a standard error is there. So that means this is nothing but it is the standard error of mean. We used to write a SEM. Okay, this is the SEM only. Okay, so SEM, from SEM to SED, how will get? You just multiply it with the square root of 2. Okay, root over 2, if you multiply it with the root 2, then you will get the SED. So this is nothing but this is the your standard error of mean.
Sir, I have a question if I can ask.
Sure, sir.
Sir, when we are going for the test, do we need to put the descriptive data and the significance level, we need to put it or not?
Sir, I didn't get.
When we are going for Duncan test or LSD test, there is option for descriptive statistics. We need to select that or not?
No need. It is so means what's the use that descriptive statistics? It will give you some descriptive mean, median, all those things. If you need it, you can use it. But for this, I don't think so. It is very very essential in this case.
And so what about the significance level? We need to set it or we need to always put it 0.5 like that?
Means where?
There is an option, a significant level where we can put how much the significant variant we
okay. So it is sometimes it is depends on experimenter also. If you want the high precision, if you want to check at 0.1 level or 0.1% or 1% or 5% or 10% also, so you can specify it there, or means what level you want to check your experiment. So it actually depends on you. Generally, in agricultural experiment, we used to see the 5%, and those who are in this lab work and all used to see in 1%.
Yes, sir. Thank
you. So any other questions, sir?
No, sir. Thank you so much.
Okay. So next LSD. So now I'll go a bit fast. Okay. Because so many examples are there. So I'm just copying it. This is the LSD practical. So I'll use new data. What are the components? Row, column, treatment, and yield. So you just rename it. Row, column, treatment, yield. So here also, similar procedure, analyze, general linear model. We'll go to univariate. So now here, yield is our dependent variable and all R will be your fixed factor. Select all and take it as a fixed factor. So now we will go to model. Similarly, you have to custom the model. So if you see the ANOVA source of variation, in there is a treatment row and column. Error and total will automatically come. Okay, no need to specify here in model. So take first row, column, and treatment. So all three are included in the model. So you should continue it and go to option overall mean and treatment means, then continue. You told this this descriptive statistics, I think, sir.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. I was asking for this thing only when we are going from, you know, univariant thing.
This will give you some descriptive mean, median, all those things. Na, so this one you can easily calculate. Or is up to you. If you need some descriptive statistics, yeah, you can use it.
Thank you, sir.
Yes. Continue. And then, actually, we should use the postdoc test when our treatment is significant. Okay. If it is not significant, if you use the postdoc test, so you will not get the any subset there. You will get only single subset, because that Duncan it will not be able to separate the into different subset if it is not significant. So continue, then three thing I specified, then okay. So now you check here, our prime importance is treatment. So you here also treatment are significant. So here also we'll get the Duncan grouping. The Duncan grouping. Similarly, here also you can write A, B, C. Similar way here A, B, C, D. There will be four letter. Similarly, if you start from back A, B, C, D, you can give from you can start from front or you can start from back also. So I think, and this will be your SEM, standard error of mean. For each character, there will be one SEM. And if you know the SEM, you can easily calculate the CD. So here it will not give you the CD directly, okay, in SPSS. So you have to calculate it, CD value. You only get the standard error mean. So next I'll go to factorial experiment, okay. See, if you have suppose always I used to go to univariate. So when you will go to multivariate option, actually multivariate option is nothing but when you have a more than one variable, like here see I have seed weight, biomass and harvest index, three variable. So in that case, instead of going to your univariate, I'll go to multivariate option. And see the experiment. This is 3×4 factorial experiment. That means first factor has a 3 level, second factor has a 4 level. So here nitrogen dose is the your second factor, it has a 4 level, and spacing is a first factor, it has a your 3 level. Okay, so four different dose of nitrogen and three different spacing. Okay, so in that case that arrangement will be so like this. So there will be a first combination for first application, then again same combinations, second application, again same combination, third application. That means all replication will be one after another. So here I'll show you. So here I will take three variables, okay, seed weight, biomass and harvest index, together I will do. So I'll just copy it. File, new data sheet. Okay. Then I will paste it here. Okay. So now I'll see nitrogen spacing replication. Accordingly, you change the variable name. First one is our nitrogen, second one is spacing, then third one is replication. Then variable name, you have to know seed weight, biomass and harvest index. Seed weight, biomass and harvest index. So I have renamed the variable name. So now same procedure, we'll go to analyze general linear model. So instead of univariate, we'll go to multivariate option. Okay. See here. So now you see the space. Here space is increased. So here previously when you select the univariate, there is a space for only one variable. Okay, one dependent variable space. Now there is a, you can include more variable. So now our dependent variable will be seed weight, biomass and harvest index. The three will be in dependent variable. Okay, and these three fixed factor. So now here we have to write the model. Okay, so I will write the model for factorial. Go to custom. First take first include the replication in the model. Second take the is main factor separately. First nitrogen effect, then effect due to spacing, then spacing, then interaction between factor A and factor B. That means interaction between dose of nitrogen and spacing. So how will take this interaction? First click on the N, then press the control key, then again click on the S. Now click on this arrow. Okay, see it will come as a interaction N into S. Okay, see I am doing again. So first click on the N, then click on control key, press the control key, then click on S. See both are selected. Then now click on this arrow. So you will get the interaction here. Okay. Now go to continue. So now see the option overall mean. If you need, you can take, you can see all the means. Continue. Then go to post-hoc test. Post-hoc test here. See, for interaction, you will not get any post-hoc test. For interaction test, post-hoc test is only for your main effect. Okay. See, main effect is a nitrogen one, and another is spacing. So for nitrogen and you'll get for spacing. For replication, no need to see the post-hoc test. See, I'm clicking, click the Duncan test. You can use other test also. LSG test also you can use. Continue. So now all three is completed. Now click on the OK. Now see here, nitrogen has a there is a four different dose of nitrogen, 1, 2, 3, 4, and three different spacing and three replication. So now you see here, this is the ANOVA. Okay, see, we have a three variable. That's why one after one they are giving. If you have a 50 variable, you can do once in one shot. You can analyze all the 50 variable. Okay, at a time. So now you see here for nitrogen, all the among the three variable, all are significant. Okay, spacing 0.016. That means SW is significant. But this biomass and harvest index, see the significance value 0.57, and for harvest index it is 0.90. So 0.57, it is more than 0.05 or 0.01. Similarly, 0.908 also, it is higher than the 0.05 or 0.01. That means these two are not significant. Only significant is seed weight, SW. Okay, since it is 0.016, it is significant at 5%, not in 1%. Okay, 0.016. It is more than 0.01, but it is less than 0.05. In interaction, only one is the two is significant. This is at 1% and 5% both significant, and this is only harvest index is significant at only 5%, and by this biomass is not significant. since it is more than 0.05 or 0.01. So now if we see the Duncan grouping, see, since this different dose of nitrogen, all the variables are significant. At least here you will get the subset. Here you got the two subset. Here two subset. Here two subset. So, but in case of spacing, only C2H was significant. Other two is not significant. That's why you will get here only one subset. They are unable to separate it. That means all here all different types of spacing does not have a significant effect. All are equal. Similarly, for harvest index also, spacing is not significant. Okay. And for standard error of mean SEM, SEM for spacing in case of seed weight is 0.021. For biomass, it is 2.74. For harvest index, it is 1.661. Okay, this is your standard error of mean. And for nitrogen, these are the standard error of mean. So once you get the standard error of mean, you can easily get the your CD value. See here, since in this case for spacing, biomass and harvest index, they are not significant. So in this case, no need to calculate the CD value and all. Okay, I already told it. See, if it is not significant in the ANOVA, so you should not go further calculation. No need to calculation of CD, SEM, nothing you should calculate. And even Duncan also, if you calculate also, you will not get anything because there is no significant difference. Okay, but if it is significantly different, then you go to calculation of CD and then go to pairwise comparison Duncan test. So there is one more example is there. It is 2 × 3 × 2. So yeah, you can try it. Okay. So now I'll go to split plot design. This is one of the important design. So in split plot design, see, we have a main plot, subplot, and replication. Here we have two main plot and 5 subplot. And each are replicated 3 times. There is a 3 replication. Okay. This is the data arrangement. So now how will do the analysis? Split plot. First, I'll copy the data. File, new data. So now we should rename it, because if we do not rename it, you will be confused while writing the model. Main plot, subplot, replication. So for renaming, we will go to here, variable view. Main plot, subplot, replication. Suppose I give any name, yield, suppose. Okay. So now we'll go to analyze, general linear model. So here we'll go to univariate. Since we have only one variable here, yield only. Okay, one dependent variable. So see here, there is a space for only one variable. So your yield will be your dependent variable and all other will be your fixed factor. Okay, so now here, you should know how to write a model here. Okay. So now you go to model. So go to custom. So I already told how to write the model for split plot. Okay. first I will take the replication in the model. Next, main plot will be there. Okay. And third will be error one. So how will write this error one? Error one is main plot into replication. Okay. If you write main plot into replication, you will get the error one. Then you have to include the subplot in the model. Then there will be interaction between main plot into subplot. Main plot into subplot interaction. Okay. So this is the ANOVA. This one I already told in slide. I'll show you. See, the first is your replication, then main plot, then thirdly error one means main plot into replication, then subplot. I've taken subplot, then main plot into subplot, and this error two and total will be automatically calculated. Okay, no need to include in the model. So if you know the source of variation, you can easily write the model, and you can do any type of design, any type of analysis. Okay, so now the model is complete. So continue. So now next is, here one thing you have to see, we'll go to option. Display means for overall we can take main plot, we can take subplot. You can see, continue. So in case of split plot design, see, there is a two error. I already told there is a two error. Okay, there is a two error, but in other design there is only one error. So here, while writing the model, we have given in error one main plot into replication. Okay, so now see here, you here how we are getting the F ratio. See here, mean sum of square due to main plot divided by error MS one, means this MS E, error MS one, we are dividing it by error MS one. But for subplot, means when we are calculating the F ratio, it is dividing by error two. Okay, mean sum of square due to subplot, it is dividing by mean sum of square of error two. Okay, so now in this case, what will happen? SPSS, it will, instead of dividing the F ratio by mean sum of square due to error one, it will divide by error two, because the software it is not able to identify error one. Okay, so that's why, see, when you will get the output, there will be a small mistake. Okay, so that one you have to, you got my point. So that's why you should modify this code a bit. So so how will modify it? There is a one option, you see, paste option. Okay, there is a one option called paste. You have to click on the paste. See, I click on the paste, there is one syntax editor came. Okay, this is the total syntax. Okay, for this analysis. Okay, so after all the syntax, there is a full stop. Full stop means the code is stop. Okay, so first you remove this full stop. Okay, and press the enter key, then write one code here, small code. What you have to write here? Test slash test what here we have to test. We have to test the main plot versus main plot into application. Then put the full stop. That means here you have to test the main plot versus main plot into rep. That is error one. So that means while calculating the F ratio, you should divide the main plot MS by error one, not by error two. So that's why this code I have written here. Okay. So this will give you the separate table. So after writing this code, you put the full stop. Okay. Then you go to run option, run, then run all. Okay. So if there is a 2-3 code is there, then you have to select and then run selection. Okay. So now you can run all. So now see here. A main plot, how many main plot? There is a 2 main plot, 1 and 2. Subplot, there is a 2 subplot. There is a 5 subplot. It means 1 to 5 and 3 replication. Now come to ANOVA. See here. Main plot. What is the F ratio? F ratio for our main plot treatment is 0.016. And significance value, probability value is 0.901. Actually, this is the wrong. Okay. So this one for main plot one, we have to see in this table. Okay. Custom hypothesis test. The code we have written. So in this, you see what is the F value? F value is 0.020. 0.20. Here F value is 0.016. Actually, this F value is 0.020. Okay. Though the your significant value is not much different, is almost equal. Okay. But in some case, it may happen that here you will get the non-significant, but here you may get the significant. But sometime you may get, in this case, it is non-significant, but here it is significant. Okay. So that's why you have to check this main plot or the significance of a main plot by using this this code. Okay, because while calculating the F ratio, the software will use this error. Okay, this error MS means they are dividing by 7.539 instead of dividing it by 6.089. Okay, actually this 0.016. This F value is coming by dividing the this mean sum of square due to main plot by mean sum of square due to error one. But software is taking software is dividing 0.120 by this one by error two, means 7.539 instead of this. Okay, so for correcting this, we use this code. So because of this mistake, we cannot perform here the postdoc test also. It will give you the misleading result. Okay. I think you got my point here. So any doubt here? Or should I continue? Hello.
Yes, sir. Continue.
Okay, sir. So next I'll go to strip plot. Strip plot, see here. In strip plot, there is a 3 error. Okay. See, the data is, there is a 2 factor, one is vertical factor and one is horizontal factor. So just copy the data. Copy. So we'll use the new data sheet. New data sheet. Paste the data. What are the replication factor A, B, and yield. So change the variable name. Replication. The factor A. Factor A. Or you can write A or B, factor B, and this is yield. Okay. So now, what is the we first will go to analyze general linear model, then we'll go to univariate. Okay. So here yield will be our here dependent variable, and all this will be our fixed factor. So actually in this analysis, our main task is to write the model only. Once you know how to write the model, you can easily carry out the analysis. Main task is to write the model. So full factorial and custom, we go to custom. So now I already told the what are the source of variation. First you take the your application, then vertical factor A, then there will be an error. So how will get this error? A into replication, that is your error one. Next is your horizontal factor. Include this factor into model, then there will be a again error two. Error two I will get B into rep. That means this is our error two. And thirdly, interaction between horizontal and vertical factor, A into B. And again, there is a third error. Third error will automatically, it will calculate. Okay. Third error will be automatically calculated. So now you check it. See the source of variation. First is replication, here replication, then factor A, factor A, then error one. How will get error one? When you factor A, when you multiply the factor A with the replication, you will get the error one. And our next is factor B, then error two. Error two, I will get factor B into replication. Then third, then our interaction between horizontal and vertical factor. This is A into B. And remaining error three and totally, it will automatically calculated by the software. Here also same problem will occur. See, when you will calculate the F ratio for factor A, we are dividing it by error A, error one. Okay, mean sum of square due to error one. But software will, the software will not understand this error one. It will divide it by error three. Okay, means EC. So here also, we have to test it separately. Similarly for factor B also, it will be divided by error C instead of error B. Okay. So here also you have to modify the code. So continue. So we'll go to option. You can see the mean A, B, A into B. So now you have to go to paste option, like split plot. Go to paste. Okay. Now see the syntax editor. So first one is for split plot, and this is our strip plot. So here we have to write the two command. You have to test A, first factor versus A into F. Again, we have to test the B also. Test B versus B into F. then put the full stop. Okay. So now I just select it. I'm selecting it and run selection. Okay. Run only selection. So now here there is a 6 replication factor A as a 3 a particle. There is a 3 particle factor and there is a 3 horizontal factor. Now you see here the factor A, it is significant here, 0.005, it is less than 0.05, it is significant. Similarly, factor B, it is non-significant. If you see the here, is it significant? See here now. So this is the wrong test. Okay. So if you want to see now on the basis of this, if you write your conclusion, okay, if you interpret the result, so it will mislead you. Okay. Because here it is showing the significant. That means your horizontal factor A, there is a significant difference. But actually, see, we test it here. What is the significance value? Probability value is 0.193. That means it is not actually significant. Due to this mistake, it becomes significant. Okay. So now, so you should test it separately. Otherwise, whatever result you will get or how you will interpret it, it will mislead you. And if you do the postdoc test on the basis of this result, it will give you the, if it is significant here, that means it will give you the postdoc some grouping, but it is not actually correct. Okay. So if you do the analysis also, you will get the wrong result. Here it was not significance. B also, see here, 0.051. okay, it is almost near to significant, but here see, it is very far from significant, 0.186. okay, so see, there is a huge difference. So now this is split plotting. Okay, first I'll go to pooled analysis. One pooled analysis I'll show. See, pooled analysis. Okay, there is 6 environment. Or 6 environment is there. 1, 2, 3. Okay. For experiment, I think there is a only 3 environment is there. There is a 3 environment, each are replicated 3 times and genotype is 10 genotype are there. Okay. So means you use the RBD design and you have a 3 different plots in 3 different environment. It may be in different location, maybe in different season you have conducted the experiment, or maybe different year. Okay, so 3 different environment is there. So now how you will do the pooled analysis? So before carrying out the pooled analysis, you have to do the individual analysis first. Okay, then you have to check the homogeneity of the variance. Okay, if it is homogeneous, then you can carry out the pooled analysis. Otherwise, you cannot carry out. So in that case, you have to go for this weighted analysis. It is different, it is bit complicated, is there. So first we'll do for simple RBD design. Okay, the 3 environment, we'll do the simple RBD first to check the homogeneity of the these 3 environment. So first I'll copy this. Copy. File, New Data. Yes. There is it. So I'll change the variable name. Genotype, application. This is environment one. This is an environment two. This is environment three. Okay. So now we already know how to do the RBD analysis. So since here we have a three dependent variable here. So we'll go analyze general linear model and multivariate, not univariate. Okay. We have to go to multivariate. So your dependent variable, the plant died of a three different environment. 1, 2, 3. Okay. This will be your dependent variable. And this will be your fixed factor. So model, we already know what is the model for RBD. To take replication and genotype, these two will be there. Or if it is treatment, write the replication and treatment, only two. Then continue. This much will be enough here to see the your homogeneity. Then I'll click on OK. Okay. See the ANOVA. So I told that according to Hartle, you can use the Bartlett test, but Bartlett test is a bit complicated, but you can use easily by using the Hartle test. That means in Hartle test, you have to see the maximum root mean square error and minimum root mean square error. Okay. See here, this error MS, which one is the maximum? Maximum is for environment one, it is 9.78. Okay, and minimum is for environment three, that is 6.5. If you divide these two, it is less than three. That means we can consider that three environment are homogeneous. So here we can carry out this pool analysis. Okay, so your test homogeneity test is over. So after seeing this, you can conclude that you can proceed to the pool analysis. So now we'll proceed to the pool analysis. So see, pool analysis, data arrangement will be, again, you have to change the arrangement of data. So previously there is a genotype replication. See, different environmental data I keep side by side. But for pool analysis, you have to see genotype replication is there. Genotype replication is there, but environment also you have to put one after another. So genotype replication for first environment, then for second environment, then third environment. So you have to change the data arrangement. So now I'm copying this data. Control C. Copy. Then file, new data. Paste. So change the variable name. First is environment, then genotype replication PS, then genotype application, then PH. So here you go to analyze general linear model univariate. Okay, so your dependent variable will be PH, and all these three will be your fixed factor. Then how to write the model? So this is the important. So in case of pool analysis, I already told the how to write the this model and what are the different source of variation. So here first you have to see the right environmental, you should include the environment in the model. Next, replication within environment. Okay, replication within environment. So this one how will write? replication into environment. If you multiply these two, you will get the replication within environment. So next, you have to include the genotype. After this, genotype into environment. Okay, so this much. So if you see the PPT, see here, for pooled one, here I read year. Instead of year, we have environment. Okay, so environment, then replication within environment, replication within environment. Then our treatment means here genotype is there, genotype. Then treatment into year means genotype into environment. And error will automatically, it will come. That means, see, once you know this different source of variation, you can easily write the model. So once you complete the model, click on continue. And then you can go to postdoc. You should go for postdoc test for only environment, only genotype, no need for others, environment and replication. So here I click on Duncan, continue, then go to option to get the means of overall mean, genotype mean will be enough, then continue, then you click on the OK. Okay, see the ANOVA, environment is there, then environment, the replication within environment, then genotype into environment, then error. Okay, so now you see here, genotype is significant. If it is significant, then see the Duncan, see here you got the different subset. Okay. So you can from here you can easily write the this in the form of ABCD, I think so. And this is your standard error of mean SEM 0.956. So should I continue or should I stop here? Hello. Hello, sir.
Hello. Sir, you can, I think, and I stop now.
Okay, so I can take some question. So is there any question?
Seema ma'am. Hello.
Hello, yes, sir.
Is there any question?
No, sir. In chat box, there is no any question.
Hello.
Okay. Sir, if
hello. Hello, Dr. Manoj.
Hello.
Yes, I'm audible.
Please.
Okay.
Yeah,
you're audible. I want to know.
Yeah.
What are the advantages and disadvantages getting the two software? SPSS and PSTAT-C. What are the advantages between those tools?
SPSS and? SPSS and?
MSTAT-C. I'm telling about MSTAT-C. MSTAT-C.
Oh, MSTAT-C.
C. Okay.
Actually, MSTAT-C also I have used previously. Actually, for this, most of the people, they will not be familiar with this MSTAT-C because it is in DOS mode, and SPSS is you can easily carry out since it is a drop down menu is there, everything is very easily you can use it, and even in output also, after getting output you can easily manage the output, SPSS output you can easily copy in Excel and you can carry out, but those output in MSTAT-C also it is in WordPad. So it is very difficult to miss. It will be time taking. Okay.
Okay. And regarding result like CD, suppose DMRT, whether results for both the case will be same or there is any variations between them?
No. The result will be same only. There will not be any variation. Okay.
Okay.
There will not be any variation.
Regarding situation, you are telling in case of SPSS, separate calculations you have to make. Okay, is it right?
Yeah. But software will not give automatically CD value.
So how that CD we can calculate on the basis of SPSS?
Yeah, we can easily calculate, sir.
How it is calculated there?
I'm telling. Wait, one minute. So, we know the SEM from the SPSS.
Okay, madam.
SEM value. Okay. So, from this, you want to calculate the CD value, nah?
Okay.
So actually, formula is, if you rho 2 into SEM into T value. At alpha level of significance, and we can say error DF. Okay. So you just multiplied the SEM with rho 2 and the T value, tabulated T value. Then you can easily get the CD value.
Okay. So in that case, we have to have the T value table. We have to have in our hand.
If you don't have T table also, you can easily get this in Excel. Okay. Suppose if you don't have the T table, F table, any table, so you can easily calculate in the Excel. So I'll tell you, I'm telling you. So for this, suppose if you want to T value at suppose 5 degrees of freedom and 5% level of significance. Okay. So for this, what you have to write? You have to write equals to TINV. Okay. TINV. TINV. See, there is a
TINV.
There is a two options. Is there, see, inside this, one is probability, one is degrees of freedom. Probability means if you want to see 5%, probability will be 0.05. Then comma, degrees of freedom, what I told 5. Okay, then complete. Bracket complete, then in enter, then you are getting the, this is the tabulated T value. So if you compare this value with the table value, any statistical table value, it will be same only. Okay. Sir, did you got?
Thank you. I have got. And whether we can get your PowerPoint presentation?
Yes, sir. I'll share it.
Okay. That will be helpful.
We will share, sir. Don't worry.
Hello.
Okay. Thank you. Thank
Hello.
You. Hello. I have questions. I have got questions in chat box, sir. Question is from Lokesh G. He is asking regarding heat maps. If possible, give some information.
Actually, graphics and all, I use the R, and I can recommend that R is the best for graphics and all. Even for this also, some disadvantage I told in SPSS for calculation of different, suppose CD, SEM, all those things. Whatever thing we cannot calculate in SPSS, we can easily write a code and we can easily use R. R is the best software for these graphics and all. Okay, heat map and all, we can easily create. Hundreds of different types of heat map we can create.
Thank you, sir. One more question is here. Question is from Kailash, sir. Which is the basic book of stat for studying to start?
Basic?
Book.
Okay. Actually, basic book on which topic? Design or some other topic is there? You should mention the topic. Or for which topic?
There is no any topic, sir.
Actually I'll tell some for basic
design. Mean, he is asking for design.
For researcher is best book is Gomez and Gomez. That is the ultimate book. Okay, once you read the Gomez and Gomez, so every confusion will be clear. There is so many book in the market all are somewhat copied from Gomez and Gomez, but Gomez and Gomez book is the masterpiece. Okay, you can read it. Once you read, all the your query will be clear. Okay.
Okay, sir. Next question is from Ajit Basa. Did Bartlett test and Hartley test give same result when there have more than two characters?
More than two characters. Character.
Yes, sir.
I think so. I'm not sure. I've not tried it. Actually, Hartley test, it is just a thumb rule. He has given it. It's a very easy procedure. We generally follow it. For Bartlett test, the formula is a bit complicated. So you can calculate it, but that question, I'm not sure it.
Okay, sir. Next question is from Ramesh Bhutta. How DOE is applicable in biostatistics? Yeah.
Okay. In biostatistics, design of experiment, nah, you can use the one-way ANOVA, two-way ANOVA like this. Maximum in biostatistics, experiment is in lab condition, not in a field condition, I think so. So in a lab condition also, you can easily use factorial CRD. All those things you can easily use.
Okay, sir.
Yeah.
Is from S.I. Stalin. What is fertility value?
What is fertility?
Value.
Fertility value.
Yes,
sir. I didn't get the question. I think he may be asking about fertility gradient or something. Fertility value means the soil fertility status, I can say. So based on the fertility status, we are drawing a fertility contour map. So on the basis of that map, we'll make the blocks, so that blocks are homogeneous within itself.
Okay, sir. The last question is from Akansha Lamba. If 100 germplasm but find only 5 varieties, for further then how sort data?
100 varieties?
100 germplasm.
100 germplasm?
But find only 5 varieties. Only for 5 variety analysis.
100 varieties is there, but 100 germplasm is there.
Yes, a 5 variety for further, and then how sort data? Actually, she is asking for sorting.
Sorting is there.
How to sort? First question is how to sort.
Sorting is very easy in Excel. Na? Excel, you can easily sort the data based on your condition. In Excel, you can do it. There is a sort option is there. I think you know it. There is a sort and filter is there. You can use it. Sort, custom sort, filter. You can easily use it if it is short. Okay.
Thank you so much, sir. Thank you so much, sir.
Yes, yes. So.
Pradeep, sir, are you there?
Yes, ma'am. So just announce for tomorrow's session also. Tomorrow, 10 o'clock, we will start the third session.
Okay.
Okay. So I would request all participants, please join the session 10 a.m. morning positively. We will share the link in the WhatsApp group. Okay. Okay. Thank you, ma'am. We can close, I think, today's session.
Okay. Thank you so much, sir.
Thank you, madam.
Thank you all the participants.
Mr. Manoj, can you spare your...
Yes, yes.
Tell me your mail ID and the contact address.
Yes, sir. I'll give the organizer the. Now you can write.
Yeah.
If I tell, M. Kanti, 1984, sir. mkanti1984@gmail.com.
Mobile
8670 9397121.
Thank you very much.
Yes sir, welcome.
Okay, thank you, sir.